I'm Wade Bryce, and my armor is contempt. Joining me on VoxCast today is miniatures painter Drew Palies. Hello, Drew.
Heyo.
Welcome to VoxCast.
Thank you.
So you are a miniatures painter responsible for lots of the lovely stuff that we see for Adeptus Titanicus, the Horus Heresy, Aeronautica Imperialis, Necromunda. You've painted loads of stuff. We're going to talk about painting, I'm sure. How did you first get into Citadel Miniatures Warhammer 40,000?
I was 14, back in France. I was riding with my bicycle around city. And I just find this shop was like the shop where every teenager liked to see, think it was like big dragon skull and that kind of thing. I just entered it, and on the back, it was this incredible wall of blister. It was all metal miniature back in the time. And I just like, I was like, what is that? I asked the guys who was working here. I said, oh, it's a game. It's Warhammer. And then I was like, is that miniature? I said, it's miniature. You have to paint them. You have books. And I think I spent the next 3 weeks, I think, like sitting on the floor reading book, only book. I didn't paint anything. I just get book and read them and look at the pictures, read the story. And that much that I did, at the end of the day, the guys have to say, all right, you have to, have to go away now. So yeah, it was like, I have this memory is quite vivid. And yeah, it was awesome. My mind like just explodes. I was like, I have no idea that thing exists. Mm. And this is awesome.
Was this a Warhammer or a Games Workshop store? Or
no, it was a retailer shop. It was a really small shop in a really small street. It was really unexpected. Yeah. It's funny. Sometimes I think about like, and if I didn't went to this street at this moment, probably I won't be here. It's really...
What would you be doing instead, do you think?
At the end of the day, I think I will like find out the Warhammer shop and I have the same feeling.
I remember the first time I went into a shop and saw, like you were describing, the wall of blister packs. Mm-hmm. Because when you've never seen any of them before, and probably because I was quite small compared to how I am now, and my memory of everything was much bigger. But I do have that same really strong feeling that there was limitless potential here, almost like I don't know how many of these things there are, but I'm interested in all of them, and that started me on the journey. So the shop was very kind to let you just sit and read.
Yeah, they was really kind, and they was kind to answer to my question as well, because what's that, and what's that, and what's this, and what's this, and who is this guy? As they was answering, and it was like, yeah, when you say unlimited potential, it was, and I think it was the feeling. I had, it's still the feeling I have. It's cool when I go in the shop now. And it's really, yeah, there's so much stuff. The background is so deep. You have so much, you can read the same thing. And I remember this Tau line where the Tau, you have so many ways to read the background. So it can be really diplomatic and almost kind. Mm-hmm. And then in other ways, they have like this way or where, well, we are right, you are wrong. And this is the only way to say the thing. They are more or less like, it's more or less like the Imperium.
Yeah.
Just different way to do the things.
The Imperium would not like that comparison.
No, probably not.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
I think in 40K, in any of the Warhammer hobbies, there are so many different perspectives for hobbyists to have that some people approach with a historical mindset. They might be interested in real world history and they look for influences. Some people like the more fantastical stuff. And I think the same when people paint miniatures. Yeah. Sometimes people paint their miniatures very clean and like they're on the parade. Some people like to paint dirty and scuffed. But they both can exist on the tabletop. They're both perfectly accurate representations of what can be. It's great to see, you know, what inspires people, I think, with their hobby. So what did you first start collecting when you first actually became a hobbyist?
So it's funny because a lot of people in this VoxCast, I listen to all of them, and as always, often talk about Rock Trader and all that game. And all when I listen to that, I'm like, wow, I'm so new. My first book was the campaign book, Eye of Tyr, the Third Crusade of Abaddon. And I remember the cover. And I just get the book, and I say, who is this guy? I want him. And he gave me the blister, it was Abaddon. And I said, what he's doing? Who is this? What is this guy doing thing? And it was, this is the Black Legion. They are black badass and with gold thing. They're space marine, but with horns, basically. And I was, I love that. So I get Abaddon, who was my first model. And then after that, because I didn't really knew what to take. I remember my first model I painted was a world standard bear of Nurgle, a metal one, the one with the big belly plate.
I remember that, yeah.
And so, yeah, it was my first one. I went home and I put paint, enamel paint and thing on it. Ink I had from the art class we had in school, that kind of thing. It was a massacre. I don't have this miniature anymore, which is, I don't know if it's sad or good. But yeah, it was I remember I enjoyed that a lot, like just being able to do whatever you want with the miniature. And from that grow the fact that actually the miniature become a medium, and all you like, you can put it in it. So if you're more, like you say, depending of the people, different thing you like, really clean or really with a lot of weathering stuff, everybody can take his own take, can have his own thing on his own miniature, and actually the miniature become his own miniature, his own story. And every time you see your guys on the tabletop or in the cabinet, you hear the noise, you hear their voice, you know what they do. It's like an incredible feeling. And that's probably what make me love painting. At the end, painting is my thing. I really like painting because I believe how I see it, like painting is storytelling. And I had a really good memory back in the time when I was in the summer camp. I was around the fire, gathering around fire, and we have this guy who was saying story, all right, from a book, a different story. It could be like, it wasn't Warhammer, it was a lot of different thing. And I remember that I had all the image in my mind, like the battle, the quest, the epic stuff. And when I see Warhammer, when I see a pictures, when I hear an audiobook, when I read a book, I have exactly the same feeling. And I think what Game Workshop do, it's a huge storytelling thing. So that's what make me into the hobby, I think.
So how did you learn how to paint? Were you taking lessons or did you teach yourself?
I discovered this shop, and me and my friend was hanging out at the end in this shop. But the shop wasn't only about this, it was a side activity for them. So I take a long time to find an actual Game Workshop shop, because back in the time, so I had a computer really late in my life. And so I wasn't able to look in the internet. So we was just our friend in the playground at school with our miniature, was making up everything, even the rules. We know it was a game, but we was like, yeah, this guy is strong. And this guy is smaller, so he's probably weaker. So he crush him. That really silly stuff when I think about it now. And
I used to play similar games. So I was just thinking with friends of mine, and it came down to how well you could convince your friend that your unit could kill his
exactly
unit.
That.
Because look at it, it's really big. Yeah. Your unit's dead.
I remember I was playing Black Legion. He was playing Ultramarines. And we had this big foam block of something, so it was supposed to be a fortress, and the Ultramarines went on top, and he said, "Oh, you can't shoot me." And I was, "What?" I said, "They are in the fortress. You can't shoot me." And I was, "How am I supposed to play?" "Oh, you lose." And it was like, I feel like that was so unfair. And so I think at this moment I was, all right, I need to find the actual rule just to prove him you're wrong. So wrong. And so I went again with my bicycle all around, and I find a shop who was back in the time in Saint-Lazare in Paris, who is still open, still my favorite shop. All the shops are my favorite, but this one is my third one.
First.
And then, the staff introduced me to painting, the actual rules, that kind of thing. I had a demo game, introduction game, and for the painting, I just, back in the time, I was really shy. I didn't want to bother anyone with my question, so I just tried to copy the thing in the White Wolf, on the box. I tried to copy that with not much success, but it was really fun. And by just practicing, I get better and better. I do try to enter a few local competition in the shop, just to get feedback from people. And that's more or less actually of most of my time I learned how to paint. It was really on my side trying to copying thing. And then when I grew up, actually, I had a computer and then internet, which was a brand new word. And then I find forum online, other people who was painting as well. And then because it was internet, I was able to go through my shyness, if it is. So because it's internet, so you can interact with a lot of people. And then I start to post thing in internet. And people give, you should do more that way. It will be better that way. You don't have an highlight. The funny thing is that I wasn't doing any highlight. And the first time, one of the guys said, you should do highlight. Sounds so time consuming. I will never do that of my life. And it's really funny because this is a big thing now in my work, highlight sharpness and all that kind of thing. So it's really funny when you think about. and so... That's how I grew up as I was probably, 20, 21, 22, all this time. It was more about internet, the community, how people, the community is, I think, the painting one, helpful. And I was really happy to engage with people. It was hard to find people who give you the right advice. But when you find them, they was really keen to help you. And was something I really appreciate. It's something I try to do as well, as much as I can. Because I remember I really struggled when I was younger to get painting advice, to find the good person. Now with the social network, it's easier. And I feel like it's almost like a duty to try to help the new guys into the hobby. Because that... my work is trying to inspire them and excite them about what we do, but my personal hobby is to share and help people who are like-minded. So this is something I try to do as much as I can.
I imagine it would be very easy to think there's so much social media, someone else will be telling people what to do. It would be easy to think that you don't need to do it, but it's great to know that you see that as a responsibility to be involved still.
Yeah, dutiful thing. It's a imperial thing. And so it's really an event. I try to go in all the event we do, because it's always an amazing feeling. I remember, sadly I don't remember his name, but he was struggling with painting white, and he showed me pictures on his phone, and I was wait a minute, I can actually really help this guy, because this is my work, this is what I do for a living, and he wants to improve. And I give him advice, and he was just like, I never thought about that. You know, this thing, if nobody tell you, you can't guess.
No.
And that was an awesome feeling to be able to really be in touch with people and help them. And some of them I'm still in, with people who ask me advice, I'm still in contact with them, and they send me pictures time to time. And it's really an awesome feeling to see them improve and being happy with themselves. And that's
great. So when you first got the internet and you were able to see other painters, were you then exposed to other styles of painting for the first time?
I've been exposed to the French scene painting, who was the French team for Golden Demon, who had a kind of particular style. I think I didn't know this scene because I wasn't into. I was more seeing that from the outside, but I know it was different than what I can see in the packaging of Game Workshop. And I also been exposed to scale modeling painting, who was really different, more realistic. And then Spanish painter, Italian painter, American painter, all that kind of thing. I get exposed to that, and I think it influenced me in a certain way, at least because you know what you want to try to do, you don't want to do. And it's to learn. I think that the best way to learn is to copy at the beginning. It's to copying and practice, basically the two fundamentals for me, at least for the skill set. And then I get exposed to so many things that I tried so many different things, except the highlight, because I wasn't still, it's so time consuming. But I was really into the realism thing. And then I come across on the internet the what was doing Mark Bedford, Phil Studzak, was painting the amazing tongue thing, and so I tried to do that as well. It's something I still do. Mm-hmm. I still like the weathering. I think now it's about finding the middle ground every time, because a lot of weathering then doesn't fit the purpose we want to do for the box art. Not every time, because if you have in real, if you have a tank who is like 2,000 year old, will be probably covered in rust, but you can't do an orange tank if it's an ultramarine tank. So you have to find the balance every time. But yeah, I get exposed to that, and that's why I think I ended by having my own style at one point. And that's what make me progress, because being exposed to so much thing, you say, I like that, I like that, and I like that. And then you ask these guys, how you do this specific thing, how you do this specific thing, and you build knowledge on that and copying it.
So do you tend to ask how a painter did something first, or do you look at the finished result and try to work it out and paint it yourself first and then ask for advice?
So because I'm shy, first of all, I'm gonna always try to figure out that by myself, but I'm often wrong. So I try, and I'm like, doesn't look like the same, and I try again and again and again until the point I'm like, I think I need to ask him, and then I ask him, and so usually sometimes maybe more or less like I do, but in slight really a slight different thing, and then it's again it's the thing like if it don't tell you, you can't guess, and so yeah, I usually tend to try to look to figure out by myself. And then ask.
And do you think that copying finished examples of the house style that Games Workshop uses, is that still good advice for people who want
Absolutely.
To maybe join you?
If we want one day, if anyone want to join the company in this work, and that's what I learned, the best bet is to copy what we do. And that's where I learned that I have to do highlight, which is, it's fun, because. So the highlight thing for me in my head was it's time consuming. In real life, thing don't have highlight, and I was like, doesn't make any sense. And then, I realized that actually this highlight are not just here for fun or just for because it's look pretty. They have a purpose, and that's why I learned what is the difference to paint for you and paint for a purpose and paint for pictures and paint for a box art. And that's why in my mind I was like, all right, do make sense. Because with this highlight, you split the model, you have to see the volume better, you highlight the sculpt and the design. And that's where in my mind, so it wasn't that far ago. It was like, probably five, six years ago. So, and I was like, I know it sounds silly, but I was like, it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
And I have to do it. I have to do that. And I try, and I was, wow. All right. And it's funny because since this day, every time a friend of mine say, what do you think about a miniature? You need more highlight. So, and that's where I start to understand what it is to paint for myself and to paint for someone else. Which is, I think, absolutely not the same thing.
So when did you decide that you wanted to be a full-time painter professionally? And what did you have to do that?
So it was like now four or five years ago. So I was painting for my stuff. And a lot of, I got really good reaction on the internet, on social media. And people start to following my stuff. Back in the time, I was painting a horror series in miniature, a huge Sons of Horus army. This army was cool because we didn't had any guideline yet, and the studio back in the time didn't make any model, so we had to figure out what is the color described by the books. So we have like a small community doing a lot of color testing, like mixing Caliban Grey with Seabird Green. Is that a good color? I don't know. In the book, they say ocean greeny blue. Is that ocean greeny blue? And so at the end of the day, I finished by finding the thing I was happy with and people was actually happy with, because a lot of people asked me for the color recipe. And so it ended up by I did that, get people following my work, and I start to build up confidence in me. Mm-hmm. And then I did more and more work, like I say, shared in the internet. And at one point, I said, you know what? Being paid for that won't be really a bad idea. Mm-hmm. And back in the time, I see Forge World opening a position as a painter. And I applied, and they say no. They say no because I wasn't good enough, which make perfect sense. And then I decided to involve all my life and all myself into reaching the goal of being able to have this job. So back in the time, I was a store manager for Game Workshop, mm-hmm. a shop of Versailles near Paris. And I was, being a store manager is a huge responsibility. You spend a lot of the time planning and you don't have necessarily the time to spend all the time you will want to improve yourself, yeah. if it makes sense. Yeah. And so I decided that I need to stop to do everything and just to be able to do that. And so I just stopped doing this job. And I also thought I need to be in a dangerous position. It was a bit crazy. and I need to be in the dangerous position where I don't have any backup plan and say, you know what? I'm going to move to UK. And I just moved in UK, landed in London. It was 3 years ago now. No job, my backpack. And I was, all right, I'm going to be a professional painter now. And well, bold move. Yes. and then, so I just arrived in London and I was all right. I don't have any brush, any miniature, nothing, right? And I just find, yeah, I need to find a home. I need to find that, all that kind of thing. So at the end, it worked out. I get home and then I get my first miniature and I buy three primary color. And I painted the miniature, put it online. I say, hey, I can paint your miniature now if you want. Just doing that. And actually, people was happy with that. So I did this. I became a freelancer painter, mm-hmm. keeping in mind that this was the only, this was a tool to be able to reach the position in the studio. Mm-hmm. Because that way, I was able to paint 10 hours a day, every day, every week. And for me, in my mind, that was the only way possible to get the skill necessary.
Yep.
So I did that for 2 years. I was really lucky to have a lot of different projects. I painted armies. I painted really high level miniature. In the meanwhile, I get a good friend around me who was like Martin Grandbaum, who was my mentor, more or less, and ask them feedback. How can be better? How can be better? It was my obsession for 2 years. That was my obsession. How can I be better every time? Every time I take the brush, because I assumed that Game Workshop will only recruit the best, and I wanted to be this guy. So yeah, I just spent an insane amount of time doing that, and I keep in touch with guys in the studio, heavy metal painter, designer. I was lucky enough to have few friends, so people I know in the studio who was designer, and I was sending them message, what do you think about that? What do you think about that? And now when we are together, we're thinking about that a lot of thing. But yeah, it was a big involvement, and when I'm thinking about that, I'm really happy I did that. I mean, that was probably the best move in my life so far. and yeah, it's just, yeah, I wanted to do it, and I assumed it was we needed to be the best, and I did everything I could to be the best. Or, I mean, it's the bold statement to say the best, but one of the best, or one people fit.
Yeah, you want to aspire to be the best, certainly.
Yeah, exactly. Aspire, yeah. I'm not the best. We aspire to be the best, I think.
I remember seeing that photograph on Facebook. It came up again recently where you shared at the 3-year anniversary of you're moving to England.
Yeah.
Three pots of paint, natural light.
Natural light. I was in the kitchen. I was like in the dining table of the kitchen, like trying like that to paint like that. I mean.
And can you paint a whole miniature just with those three primary colors?
Yeah, absolutely. You need to mix the color. Yeah. It's like, it's color theory. Mm-hmm. If you mix the color, you can have more or less any color. Well, the miniature wasn't the best in the world at the end of the day. The basing was inexistent. But yeah, you can paint a miniature with three color. Obviously, you can't achieve what we can with a full range like we have now. But yeah, you can. You can kinda.
Yeah, yeah. Approximate. Yeah. Until you get the rest of the paints. Yeah. So did this teach you the differences, I guess, between painting for fun, painting for yourself, and painting professionally?
Absolutely. So first of all, when you aim for a position as a painter, you have to understand the expectation of people. And this is a thing I also learned during freelance. People expect you to do something, right? To fulfill a purpose. And that's what your miniature is supposed to be, fulfill purpose. It can be different purpose. It can be the work I'm doing now is like looking good, inspiring people on packaging and on advertisement. It could be looking good on the army and thing. And that's where you understand that you have to switch your mindset, and you're not painting for yourself anymore. The miniature is not your miniature. The miniature become an asset. Mm. And your aim and the dedication you should have is to reach as close as possible as the expectation of the people who ask you to paint the miniature. On a daily basis, it's my manager who asked me, it's the company who asked me, but it can't be anyone. It could be, I mean, when you paint for, it's the difference, I think, between design and art. Mm. So I'm not an expert on that kind of thing, so I had a discussion one day with Max Falesh, who is heavy metal painter, mm-hmm. Citadel, who I think told me that it was a discussion he had with Jess Goodwin. So these two persons combined probably is a good reference. We were talking about the difference between art and design. And I think at the end of the discussion was like the difference lay in the purpose of each of them. Yeah. Art, the purpose of art is to do something you enjoy and who can provoke emotion and thing to people with it. While design is supposed to fit a purpose and to answer and to give information and to be useful. Not saying that art is useless,
no.
But it's a different purpose.
And art doesn't have to have a purpose. Exactly. It can do, but it doesn't have to.
When we paint, our primary job is to paint as well as we can. It's what we call the rendering thing, having sharp highlights, mm-hmm. having vivid color, clean, good level of finish and all that kind of thing. This is the application of the process. But before that, you have all the part of, and everybody do that naturally, I think, is like, who is this guy? Why he's not wearing his helmet? What the base will be, what is the word he evolved, and all that thing is the kind of thing it's question, and then design is answering those questions, and we do that through painting. Mm-hmm. So when I paint a miniature, we ask around about writer, illustrator, designer, manager. What are they doing? Are they good guy, bad guy? Where planet are they? Who they are fighting? What their purpose? And then using all this information, you do a brief. Mm-hmm. And then when you have this brief, all right, how I gonna explain all that in the painting? Because at the end of the day, when you see a Game Workshop painting, you should be able to understand what it is without word. This is, it come back to our storytelling. Mm. When you see a pictures of one of the miniatures, you should be able to understand what happened in this miniature. Mm-hmm. And that's our work, and that's how we spend time to think about beforehand of what they are doing, what is the miniature, and yeah, that's I think the main difference. The main difference is art ask question, design answer to them.
Yeah, that's a good definition. Yeah. I like that. Thanks, and we've talked to miniatures designers in the podcasts and live shows before, the responsibility the miniatures designers have to tell that story, to articulate, to communicate everything that hobbyists need to know about a miniature with no words. They can't come on the podcast and explain it. They might be, well, people around the world with no common language will see all these things. So the impressions that the miniature conveys, the heaviness, the weight, if it's got horns with skulls on them, maybe a bit evil. The miniatures painters have to refine and make that even more clear, and all of the textures and the materials have to be apparent. That's a big responsibility. And you're working with some very talented people as well. So I know that you have Phil Dunn as a miniatures designer in your studio, who was
ex-heavy metal painter.
Mark Bedford's pretty good at painting and making stuff as well. So it must be great to be part of that collaborative atmosphere.
Well, I'm used to say when everybody say, "How you feeling?" I'm saying, "I'm feeling like it's a privilege to be in the studio where I am," because we have. If you combine the knowledge of everybody, it's insanely huge, and it can be different knowledge. It can be a design. What for designer? It could be what this flow mean. The flow of this gap mean. It can be a really different thing. And all of these guys, some of these guys have long career in Game Workshop. So some of them, like Phil Dunn, was ex heavy metal painter. We have Keith Robinson as well, who's working for. He was a heavy metal painter. So I tend to try to be really inclusive in my way to work, to be able to have a lot of the experience of everybody, because I think it will be criminal to not using it. I usually, when I build up a project, I start to ask everybody around. So I ask like the writer, like Anoush, who was in the VoxCast. Who is this guy? How you see it? The idea is that when you want to transmit an idea, when you want to paint a miniature, this miniature, how I see it, should be the representation of what everybody in the studio think it should be. That should be what writers, designer think it should be. So you need to have all these guys who do different thing, who write background, who concept, draw, and design, transmit their idea. And then you work this out to make it, all right, this idea is great. How can I make it work on the miniature in 3D? How can I make it work on pictures? And that's our work. And I think it's being the more inclusive possible is one of our strengths. Because we are not a lone painter in this office, right? We are a group of people, and we are a team, actually. We are a studio, and everything we do at the end should be satisfying for everybody. And because it's satisfying for everybody, it will be satisfying for the customer. I think that's how I see it.
That's a good system. I think that's decent. So how do you keep testing yourself now that you are a professional miniatures painter? You're here, you're in the studio. How do you keep making sure you're getting better?
So I think it come down from, so I think it's a mindset thing. It come down from cruel honesty with itself. Not that I say you should never be happy in general, but don't be happy. Don't settle on what you're doing. It's a good feeling to be able to finish a project and to be finished, and you have to appreciate this moment. But usually for me, I'm happy for 10 minutes. And then after this 10 minute, I'm like, yeah, it could be better. how I push myself is really easy. It's like, you have to keep in mind that you have a duty and the responsibility to do the best as you can, And every time I do the best that I can, I know I can do that. So I know, let's say this is my limit, right? But I didn't die about that or something. So I probably can go further. And then I push against myself. And I take the project I just finished like an hour ago. Say, all right, what I want to do better than this one? And I do a kind of to-do list. I can write it down or... and it will be, all right, this thing needs to be sharper. I need to work on the color system. I have to that to work on that and that. Also, because we are a team again and we are not working to get, alone, asking feedback of colleague is, I think, vital. Because sometimes you can be caught in the tunnel vision. Yep. You only see a thing or you lose sight of different thing, and having your colleague say, yeah, but it can't be like that. It's always, oh, yeah, right. Oh, I completely forgot that. Mm-hmm. Or you missed something here. Because when you, sometimes we can spend weeks on the same project and you can lose sight of things. So it's always good to heads up, look around, okay, guys, what do you think about that?
Yeah.
And usually they pick stuff. So they say, oh, this could be better. This is great, but it could be, nah? And so, having this input of feedback, having the input of people who actually don't paint, because everybody can have a great idea. Mm. So having people, designer, illustrator, seeing the model, say, oh, for example, why is it like that? If they don't understand something, it probably means something is wrong.
Yep.
So you have to rethink that. And so it's how I keep myself trying to go on is taking on board everything people say, being really honest with yourself, because it's easy to, yeah, it's good. Or the worst thing you can probably say, it's good enough, which is absolute, I think, not ideal. Mm-hmm. In other end, you also have to work out with deadline and thing, which is part of the design process. Because with art, you could work out for years on the same thing. With design, you have to be done. You have this deadline, and it's like a mind gymnastic, because you want to do the best thing possible, but you have this deadline, so you have to be the more efficient possible. And so it makes your brain like always running like crazy. It's also part of how you're doing better, because you can be an excellent painter, but if you don't meet your deadline, it's an issue.
Yeah, that's the two parts of being a professional painter, isn't it? Being a great painter to the deadlines.
Mm-hmm.
And you must have had experience of painting to deadlines as a freelance painter before joining the studio. How do you find the studio's deadlines?
I think because the quality is higher here, usually the deadline are longer.
Mm-hmm.
But still, I think it's still long enough to make you to make a good job. It's short enough to keep you awake.
Yep.
So I think the deadline they are. Mm-hmm. I think the deadline, and it's not like someone come to you and say, oh, you have this model, you have 3 days to paint it. Usually it's more like, all right, how many days you think you need? Of course, if you say, oh, I have a space marine to paint, I want a year, probably say nope. But yeah, it's a team effort, and everybody's asking to everyone how long you think you need. And again, it's design process to be reasonable and to have a good middle ground of how much time I want to invest, how much time I need to invest, and how I'm going to do that to make it look the best looking miniature possible.
Yeah. Yeah. And I guess an awareness of the business that you're part of. If you're a freelance painter and you don't hit your deadline, you might annoy your clients. The client might get the miniature a week later and the client might never work with you again, and that's bad. But if you don't paint something that's meant to appear in a book or is meant to go on a box, or then the whole business slows down and it starts costing people money.
You have to understand that when you're working in the company like Game Workshop, you are, again, I say that this word a lot. We are a team,
mm-hmm.
and we assume that everybody will do his job, because if we don't, you impact the job of everyone who is behind you.
Yeah.
And you don't want the people behind you to not being able to do that job because it's you. So it's really it's again, it's being self-aware of, again, a duty that you have. I keep saying this word because I think like duty, responsibility are core value of I think what painting is, because we have the duty of being the example. And we have the responsibility of, for the paint job, make people excited and not disappoint the customer as well. I think it's important.
Yeah. You want to show that limitless potential that we talked about at the beginning. Exactly. Because when you show, just looking at your beautiful Imperial Fist Dreadnought stomping around in the background, because it's animated, I can see the weathering. We've been into the hobby long enough. As you say, we hear the sounds and the sound effects and the visuals. Yeah. For the role of your studio, when you're painting miniatures, you're showing them to people who don't really know what these things look like yet. So you need really sharp highlights to show all of the features and details of the miniature. That's important to get people to understand why we think it's cool. Because I can look at a grey piece of plastic or resin, I still hear the sounds. I've been looking at it long enough now. But for new people coming in, they all need to be brought up to the same level we're at. We understand why this stuff is cool, so you need to show what we see in our heads.
When I go in the shop and I see someone I think might be a new customer, I say, I want that. Why? Because it looked cool on the box. Did my job. Yeah.
So I've mentioned it because it's looming over there on the shelf behind you, your beautiful Imperial Fist Leviathan Dreadnought. Are you still an Imperial Fist collector? You've mentioned duty and responsibility, some of the key features.
So Imperial Fist is probably my more cherished army for the values they carry. So Anush in the last forecast say that Horus Heresy is great because the Legion are like sport team that you choose to support.
Yep.
And because usually you find yourself a bit in each Legion. And I, for some reason, I find myself in the Imperial Fist. And so I did a huge 40k army back in the time, and now I'm doing my own successor chapter. But the plan is to have some proper yellow Imperial Fist at one point again. But all my Space Marine chapter are either are successor or Imperial Fist. Okay. Always.
Is this so you can create something for yourself?
Yeah, I did my Impros Havoc, who are so Imperial Fist successor. I created them last year, I think. I created them because I had in mind. So when I see the primaries first time, I was they look really a bit technology thing. And I was, that's cool, because back in the time everything was more gothic. Now we can choose to make them gothic or not, because there are options. And I already thought that I love Imperial Fist, but one of the facets I really like from them is that almost the siege attrition war that they share with Iron Warrior. But I really liked In the Space Marines, there's a thing I really like, which is they want the job done. And that's more or less my army. They don't really care about the glory. They don't care about... Well, they do care because they're part of the Imperium. But they don't have a lot of tradition. It's more about what they want. They see themselves as tool. And they want to be the more efficient and the more efficient possible. Everything who won't be efficient, they probably won't do it. So when I thought about the chapter, the really fun thing is that I thought about Astra Militarum Regiment first. So I was, I wanted Astra Militarum Regiment on a planet where actually it's the same planet where they recruit Space Marine. And I thought, what will be this planet? And so this planet is probably the perfect representation of what would be an Imperium planet without the grim dark part. It's a bit weird in a way that, so there, how they see themselves is that, yeah, you have to be the best as you can every time. And it will be a waste if you don't know what is your potential. So this planet is all about being the best as you can. Of course, because they are part of the Imperium, it will be destined for war. But for example, this planet is also a lot, they have Scholar.
Yep.
Where so they have a lot of the people going to Adeptus Terra at the end.
Mm-hmm.
And so the aim was they have probably the best education system that the Imperium can provide, and that also the best physical ability and fearless warriors have.
So the Emperor's Havoc.
Yep.
The Havoc of the Emperor. And I love that name as well, because we were talking about it, like Havoc? Like the Chaos Space Marines with big guns. Don't know what you're talking about. Don't ask questions. Are they a new chapter? Have they been more recently founded?
So the chapter was not that recent. It's not the primary chapter. Okay. So they had Space Marine back in the time. The name Emperor Havoc come from the fact that they see themselves as the final answer.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's been tried to resolve the problem, right?
Yeah.
And they are here now, and they are like a wall, mm-hmm. who gonna break everything. And yeah, they are the last answer. They are the Havoc of the Emperor.
Yeah. Is it like, was it Louis XIV who had in his cannon barrels the Ultima Ratio Rigum, the last argument of kings?
Yeah.
I love that notion of,
and
we've exhausted everything else, send in the Emperor.
This is the motto of my army.
Mm.
Not king, emperor,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah, it's a great idea, I think. And I've seen for Titan Legions, I think, like there are variations on that ultimate sanction, final weapon for Titan, for Warlord Titan, mm-hmm. names, which seems entirely appropriate. If you send in the final answer, then that's the end of
that's,
it.
Yeah.
So are they similar to the Imperial Fists? Do they interact with the Imperial Fists?
So they interact with the Imperial Fists. In the Imperial Fist culture, you have this meeting. This is a thing in the background,
mm-hmm.
where all Imperial Fist chapter successors send excessively skilled duelists. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And they compete to each other. So they definitely have contact with,
mm-hmm.
the primogenitor.
Mm-hmm.
So they are similar in the way that they are siege and urban warfare chapter. So they excel in attrition war and urban war.
They've got a much more sensible color scheme for city fighting than the Imperial Fists do.
Yeah, I come out with color scheme because so my all the thing around this chapter is about efficiency.
Mm-hmm.
This is something I like in the Imperial Fists because they have, so the Imperial Fists have this core of efficiency,
mm-hmm.
and on top of that they have the code of duty and rightfulness. My chapter have the same thing, so they have the core of efficiency, they have the duty, the feeling, they have this incredible feeling of responsibility and duty again. But the main difference with the Imperial Fists is that they are absolutely not looking for recognition, or it's not like Imperial Fists looking for recognition, but they will try to avoid everything to put them in the spotlight.
Mm-hmm.
The aim is like they want the job to be done, and that's all.
I guess the Imperial Fists as a first founding organization, there are certain expectations maybe that other institutions in the Imperium have of the Imperial Fists. Don't have those of the Emperor's Havoc. Maybe they've never heard of the Emperor's Havoc, and that allows the Havoc of the Emperor to concentrate on the job.
Yeah, they're really focused on our job,
mm-hmm.
is war,
mm-hmm.
and that's all.
Yeah.
We want to do it in the best way possible.
And have you worked out any background for the Astra Militarum Regiment as well?
So yeah, so the thing is that they come from a planet where all the planets is about war,
mm-hmm.
And so these the Emperor Havoc, who work with Astra Militarum Regiment, whose names are the Rams. Well, the thing is that usually what happens is that the Emperor's Havoc come in the planet, do their job, so they will more or less, like it's from the horror series, the spearhead formation,
mm-hmm.
like they're gonna cut the head of the resistance, and then the Rams will gonna occupy and then like a sea blade behind, mm-hmm. with a lot of, it's supposed to be an armored regiment tank, so they're gonna clean all the small resistance you will have while the spaceman will take off more serious business. And the thing I wanted also that they have a good working relationship.
Yeah.
They know how to work together because they've always been working together. And some of the commander in the Empress Havoc have good respect.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to stay away from, because they are really efficient. I think they have a part of humility as well, because they know they are just weapons. Who make them maybe more human? Mm. The Inquisition might be interested at one point. But yeah.
And how did you settle upon the color scheme for them? Was that inspired by the background or just how you wanted to paint them?
So yeah, the things that I, since the beginning, I wanted the attrition urban warfare, and I was like, all right, what is urban warfare? I went in Google, and I basically designed my project. So I went in Google and was, how look a city while doing warfare, and it's quite great. Everything's great. So the armor will be great, and I need another color. So I went for red, but I keep the red quite desaturated and mute. So I stayed away from Mephiston red in that color. Used Wadzaka corn red.
You definitely highlighted them, right?
Yep, yeah. Everything is highlighted because I want. So it's a kind-ish playing army,
mm-hmm.
but it's also, I want them to look good on pictures.
Mm-hmm.
I've been inspired by Paul Norton when he do his own space marine thing, yeah. and I was, that looks so awesome. I need to create my own chapter, and so yeah, the red, the gray, the red, the base was just urban warfare thing. And I wanted to, so the color scheme is quite simple because I wanted to have weathering on it, small scratch. So if you look around the legs, I have like small scratch all around the legs. On the red, you have a gray patch, like the red peel off. I create the own all the insignia.
Mm-hmm.
I create my own decal with, I have a sheet with all the symbol of different companies. They don't use Codex Astartes, mm-hmm. because they think they can have a more efficient way to do it.
Okay.
They are kind of doing the same thing, but because the Imperial Fist at the really beginning wasn't a big fan of the Codex Astartes, I think they are, my chapter is try to be efficient as possible, but they are a bit stubborn as well. And so the Codex Astartes, we could probably do better than that.
Imperial Fist successors being stubborn, thinking they can improve on Gilliman's Codex. That's a great setup. That's a great reason to fight other Space Marines. I guess if you find yourself across the table from another Space Marine army, you've got a great reason for why they might be disagreeing, certainly with an Ultramarines army. And is this a nice contrast to your painting at work? Does this give you the opportunity to do art for art's sake rather than part of the design process?
Not really. So at the moment, I'm really focused on my work, mm-hmm. and I try on my side project, personal project, to do things I can do to improve it work. So for example, in my army, I did a lot of small scratch thing I struggled at the beginning. And now because I made it over 30 Space Marine, I can do it at work. So I always try to have side projects who at the end will have an input in my work.
Yeah.
So faces, mm-hmm. as well. I painted a lot of faces for my Space Marine because the Space Marine have such a characteristic face.
Yeah.
And yeah, I wanted to be better at painting face, highlight on the armor, sharpness, the weathering thing.
The definition on Space Marine faces nowadays, it's really striking. And looking at Paul Norton's stuff as well, and seeing that as an example of something he was trying to practice at getting better, and knowing that would be a big part of being an heavy metal painter. It's great to see those examples, to be able to try and copy those. But yeah, we've also mentioned how lucky we are, or how lucky hobbyists who come into the hobby, even in the last 10 years or so now, are compared to the era of metal blister packs and pinning things together, and the range of things that people can chop and change bits from, as well as all the inspiration. You've got all of the visual sources that people have on the internet now, and the ability to share ideas, and it's great. But good to know that you're using this to help be a better professional painter.
I think I'm really obsessed.
How big is he? 30 models now for the Emperor Havoc.
The Emperor Havoc, actually, so I played the game last weekend. Okay. It was so 40 power level. Mm-hmm. I like to play with power level. Yeah. It's easier. It's faster. Mm-hmm. I think at the moment I have 1,500 points. So I had a lot. So how I see them operate, I like to imagine. I see, you know, I have the image on mine, and what is the discussion between the captain and the lieutenant? And so will be usually the vanguard will be the first to operate with how they're supposed to be, and so they're gonna mark what is the weak point of the enemy. So it could be building fortress, field depot, all that kind of thing. They're gonna mark that, and then usually they teleport aggressor unit or send aggressor unit to take care of that, to destroy all the vital point, and then they send tanks to just basically like a dozer blade to finish that and have no position. While some of the chapter will look for the opposition, like in the quest of. It's just time wasted for the Emperor Havoc. Yeah. They just want to make it quicker. They really do that as a duty and a work. They enjoy doing it, but they want to do it like the less casualty possible, because a Dead Space Marine is not useful anymore.
Mm-hmm. Big investment from the Imperium.
Exactly.
To replace.
So they really, so they send the Vanguard, aggressors. And then, like a dozer blade with tanks. So the next, I have the Vanguard, I have the aggressor. I actually have 9 aggressors. I want to have 12. Then the aim is to have like an army of each type of armor. So Vanguard, aggressors, I have a full company of tanks. All the kind of tanks. And my first company is only wear aggressors, because the first company is designed to purge Space Hulk. So because where they are, there's a lot of Space Hulk, the first company is here to just clean the Space Hulk, to really purge it. And the best way to do it is an aggressor armor, I think. Is again the more efficient way to do it. And that's why they have Skull. On the each aggressor have Skull to symbolize how many Space Hulk they clean.
Oh wow! Okay.
So yeah,
that's great. Have you played any games of Space Hulk using the aggressor models?
Not yet. It was an idea he gave me, Maxime Corbet. Mm-hmm. He gave me this idea. Like how I could do my first company different. I say, I don't know what is their mission? Mm. And I was cleaning Space Hulk is cool. So, yeah.
And you've got the background built in to explain why they don't necessarily do things the way other chapters might do.
So I have a background that I have to still work on it. Because Space Marine are what they are, and because they are Imperial physics, so I think everything could be explained by just third bonus.
Yeah.
And it's worked like that. It really worked like that. Why should we change, or why we should do it in a different way? It could be also just that when they get founded, it was after the Horus Heresy, and for some reason they lost contact at one point. And so, because the Imperial Fist at the beginning wasn't a big fan of the Codex Astartes, they never received the Codex Astartes. Could be a lot of reasons. I didn't figure out yet. I know the planet, the homeworld, how they work. I know all my characters have name. For example, the captain of my Vanguard come from a different part of the planet, which is more tribe one. Mm-hmm. And for example, when they're kids, the game for them is to catch big bird, bear hen, climbing a tree. And so that's why on his sniper, he have skull of bird. So all that kind of thing.
That's great.
Yeah.
So it's good to have that understanding, the big understanding, I guess, of how your army is different from other armies, and then you can keep adding elements to the story as you're telling more stories, playing more games. You don't have to have all the answers for how they differ from the Codex Astartes. Mm-hmm. You just know that they do. And if there are differences in your army, it doesn't really matter why. They just are. Like, if you have lots of aggressors for your first company, they clearly are. That's the way it is.
And that's. I think it's just the easier way. Mm. It's just like, you don't need to explain that in a way that, what is the more efficient way to clean a Space Hulk, which is small corridor and thing, that the big chunky armor with flamer or bolt.
Flamers on each arm, better than Gilliman would have suggested. Yeah, very good. So how long does it take you to paint one of your Space Marines?
An afternoon.
Okay.
It took me so I'm lucky to be a fast painter. So it takes me an afternoon to paint a Space Marine. It takes me longer to build it than than painting it. But I don't work every time on it, so I will paint one, put it on the side, or I will have an idea and just, I want new aggressor, or actually talking with one of my friends and say, what for your army you don't have that? Yeah, but what is the reason? And we think about it, we figure out the reason or something and say, I'm gonna start this unit. I don't paint in continuous way. Mm-hmm. I wish.
Do you imagine that this is a long-term project? Do you think you'll keep coming back and adding
things? It's an ongoing project. I don't have final goal for this one, so it will probably end up big.
The entire chapter? Yeah. All of them?
Yeah, they're probably not 1,000. Maybe. No. Maybe it's more.
More efficient to do it another way.
Yeah, probably. And I have a lot of different projects. I get distracted quite easy. Mm-hmm. Quite easily. So I have a lot of projects. Sister of Battle get out, get released. So I'm definitely looking at them. I already want to do another Space Marine chapter in a completely different way. I love Tau. I like Tau, so I want to do a kill team for Tau. Every time there's a new release, I'm like, I want that. Usually I get it, and then I'm like, this is not a new release again. So yeah, a lot of different projects going.
And do you have any advice for anyone who might be listening to this or watching this who thinks they might want to be a full-time miniatures painter in the studio with you? Any advice for anyone out there?
So I think the biggest thing for doing this research is to understand what we're doing. And it's not always easy to find clue. So you have to be sure that painting like we do in the box, painting Space Marine, is absolutely the thing you want to do. Because otherwise, you will be never happy. You need to copy what we do at the beginning to learn. You have to. So there's two things in the work. You need to have the mindset and the skill set. The mindset is, you need to have unconditional love for Game Workshop IP, I think, all the IPs. And to be able to be really honest with yourself and always, I would say always push yourself to be better. Not necessarily for you, but for the company. Being better. Every time, never being happy of your capacity or something, always striving to be better. And for the skill set, you need to practice again and again and again. It's really a huge amount of time, and you will still learn when you enter in the studio. It's a huge learning curve, but you need more or less to be able to do what we do before you enter the company. And the only way you can do that is by copying what we do. Come to see us in the events if you can. Reach out on social media if you can. Look at the White Dwarf. Listen at the VoxCast. Max was in the VoxCast, give great advice. It's really focus on that. Okay. Really focus.
So you don't necessarily have to move to another country and start from nothing, but you have to show
that
you've got that understanding.
Be really focused. If this is the thing you want to really do, you have to focus all your available time to do it and put all your effort in it. And to do that, you have to understand what we do, being honest with yourself, and practice a lot.
Can't say fairer than that. That is great advice. Thank you very much for your time today, Drew. I hope we can invite you back and talk about your other hobby projects at some point in the future. Well, cool. Thanks again to Drew, and thank you for watching or listening to the podcast. VoxCast will be back in 2 weeks' time, and there'll be a new episode of Stormcast released next week. See you soon.